The West Philippine Sea issue is expected to dominate the president's third sauna. What should the president say to reassure Filipinos that the government is on top of the matter? Let's get the insight of Professor Renato De Castro of the De La Salle University. Professor, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Ron. How are you doing?
I'm doing fine, sir. It may not be one of the top concerns of the people, that's according to a survey, but the issue of the West Philippine Sea is one of the topics that people may want to hear from the president. Are you expecting any big pronouncements from the president on his State of the Nation address?
Probably more clarification based on the speech he delivered at the Shangri-La Dialogue last May. Of course, the entire speech in the Shangri-La Dialogue was all about foreign policy, West Philippine Sea issue. More significantly, of course, his emphasis on the fact that the Philippines is an archipelagic state. That, of course, is emphasized in the Shangri-La Dialogue. And probably he would, again, reiterate this. You know, the first president that basically, you know, that emphasized the fact that we are an archipelagic state and the Filipino nation is a maritime nation. And on the basis of this, of course, he also mentioned about the need to pursue what is called the archipelagic defense concept. So probably he will mention it. He will probably also mention, without mentioning China, of course, this is how creative our president is. Remember during the Shangri-La Dialogue, everyone knew he was talking about China when it comes to the West Philippine Sea, but he never mentioned the issue. He never mentioned the name China. And probably he'll be also talking about the the security partnerships and, you know, developments in terms of our alliance with the United States. And more recently, of course, the in April, we, of course, signed the trilateral securities relationship between Japan, the United States, and the Philippines. And, of course, more recently, with Japan, the reciprocal access agreement. So probably he'll talking about our continuing efforts to foster our relationship with our treaty ally, the United States, and other like-minded countries. And of course, something that he also emphasized in the Shangri-La Dialogue, that we are part of what is called the rules-based international order. So basically giving a position in the light of the ongoing, you know, great power dynamics between China, Russia, and of course, versus the United States.
You mentioned it. The Philippines has forged stronger relations with the U.S., Japan, even Australia, has entered into several arrangements, security arrangements with other countries. And we have more countries decrying and condemning the actions of China, what they've been doing in the West Philippine Sea because of the Coast Guard's, what they call assertive transparency. But there have been more encounters at sea between our Coast Guards. With the worst happening in June, of course, in the Yungin Shoal, when our boats were blocked, were punctured, and several personnel injured. Can you still say that the Philippine government's actions get more backing from bigger, stronger countries, and having security arrangements with them is still one of the best ways to go?
Yeah, that's the only option we have. The other option, of course, is, again, go back to a policy of appeasing China. So, you know, this has been a policy in the last 6 years during the Duterte administration. Did we achieve anything? So we are put in a what you call a catch-22 situation. You appease China, you still encounter, of course, China's aggressive and expansionist action. You challenge China, of course, you get the same thing. But at least we do it with dignity. We're not simply accepting, you know, de facto expansion into our maritime waters. You know, it gives basically a chance for us to basically reverse the course of, you know, what China is basically impressing to us ever since, of course, the Aquino administration. We are powerful, we're expansive, we are coercive, and you cannot do anything about it.
Isn't filing another arbitration case against China another option, sir?
That is something that, of course, the president would have to consider. I know for a fact it's a recommendation by Associate Justice Antonio Carpio.
Right.
It has merits, of course, but of course, at the end of the day, like when the late President Benigno Aquino III decided to file, of course, that case in the Permanent Court for Arbitration, it's still a matter, of course, of an executive prerogative.
Okay. We want to get your thoughts on a couple of things. First, to the Philippine Maritime Zones Act, just a few steps closer to becoming law. How could this be beneficial to us? The way I understand it, and I'm just simply putting it, it's just a declaration of our boundaries. It's us declaring where our boundaries are. How could this be beneficial to us, and how could this be used against China's activities?
Ron, I'm not a lawyer, so probably the better person who could answer it will be my good friend, Professor Jay Batumbakal. I'm not familiar with the law. Mm-hmm. I'm really more focused on the strategic developments, not on the legislation. Probably the best person to talk about it will be Professor Jay Batumbakal, or of course, Associate Justice Carpio.
How about this one, sir? A recent bilateral consultation meeting, in that the Philippines says that both sides have affirmed their commitment to de-escalate the tensions. And after that, we now have an arrangement on improving Philippines-China maritime communications mechanisms. This resulted in a more and a higher level of communication between the two countries with regard to maritime issues. Will you be able to tell us the significance of that, and is it a good thing?
Ron, are you referring to the hotline?
Yes, the hotline.
Okay. Well, the assumption here is, of course, the fact that we need a hotline to communicate to China. And, of course, the People's Liberation Army is actually being directed from Beijing. Mm-hmm. So what's the point of a hotline? If actually what's happening is, of course, what I would call a coordinated, very sophisticated maritime expansion. Everything that's happening there has been getting direction from Beijing. And you will ask Beijing, there is an incident that's happening here, but for all we know, this is an instruction from Beijing. So what's the purpose of a hotline if actually what's happening there is actually part of a grand scheme of China's expansion and coercive action against the Philippines?
And Professor, right? we've always had a hotline with them. They don't answer anyway, right?
Yeah, of course. And also, I also heard it from my source in the Department of Foreign Affairs. When one time they answered, they started telling us, this line is not for you to file your complaints. Do it in the Chinese embassy in Manila.
Okay, sir, before you go, for the sauna, well, is there anything particular you would want to hear from the president regarding the West Philippine Sea?
Well, explaining to the people why we have to make the stand. And of course, explaining to the people that what we face is a very powerful, very coercive and expansionist power. That is, of course, this will be a security challenge that not only this present generation of Filipino would face, but future generations of Filipinos. And like what Commodore Jay Taliala mentioned, what we are doing here, holding the line, is actually for future generations of Filipinos. We don't want future generations of Filipinos to be deprived of their maritime entitlement in the West Philippine Sea, South China Sea. So in explaining to the people that this will be a very long struggle.
Professor Renato De Castro of the De La Salle University, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, Ron, and good afternoon.